Welcome to Christian Living 101 Bible Studies. Our mission is to prepare every believer for the trials of daily life. Listen to God's Word presented without church or organizational bias as you study with Pastor Applegate. Now we join Christian Living 101 in progress.
Well, now today we're going to get into a subject that involves the husband's relationship to his wife, what his responsibility is, how he is to govern himself, and how he is to respond and take care of that precious vessel that God has given unto him. And we want to talk about that just a little bit as we go to Genesis chapter 2, verse 20. And we're going to talk about what God says the relationship of a man and a woman is supposed to be in marriage. Let's read it together. Genesis 2:20. And Adam gave names to all cattle and to the fowl of the air, to every beast of the field. But for Adam there was not found an helpmeet for him. Now, we're talking about the creation that God brought forth upon the earth, and all of the different elements and animals and birds and the green grass and the vegetation, everything. It was all wonderful and perfect, and God said that it was good. But when he realized that Adam was left all alone to care for all of the things that God had created and was responsible to see to it that order was kept and that he needed a helpmeet. No, it doesn't say a helpmate, a helpmeet. A helpmeet is someone who is an assistant in the responsibilities of another. A helpmate is one who is the partner in developing a family, bearing children, bringing forth the procreation of man upon the earth. And there's double duty here as far as each of these people are concerned. Now today I'd like to just take the scriptural truth that the Lord says we are to abide by, and he explains what he has done. Go with me to Genesis 2. Verse 24, therefore shall a man leave his father and his mother, and shall cleave unto his wife, and they shall be one flesh. Now this is speaking of the marital relationship, of father-mother relationship, husband-wife relationship. And so it is, we're going to cover both as best we can as we go into the scripture together today. Now go with me to Matthew 19, verse 4. We're going to talk about what Jesus has to say about a man and wife relationship. Verse 4 says, and he answered and said unto them, have you not read that he which made them in the beginning made them male and female? And verse 5, and said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and shall cleave to his wife, and they twain shall be one flesh. Now verse 6, wherefore they are no more twain, that means two, but one flesh. What therefore God hath joined together, let not man put asunder. I want to just cover that a little bit. And God's purpose in creating man, we know as we read the scriptures, was to have a people who had the capacity to think for themselves, make their own decisions, do what they did by the determination of their own will. And it was a desire of the Heavenly Father to have a people that would be especially present in his kingdom, that would be a people that would bring glory and honor to the righteousness of Almighty God, that would care for the creation that he had placed upon the earth. And it must have been a great desire of his to have Adam and Eve populate the earth. In fact, the Bible tells us that he commanded them to replenish the earth, which brings us to a point that this old preacher believes that there was some form of mankind upon the face of the earth before it was finally destroyed and left void and without form, as Genesis 1:1 declares. And so the desire of God was that a man and woman would form a household, become a family as they brought forth children, and would rear those children and repopulate the earth, as it were, with God's vessels that he had created for himself to be a people unto his glory and purpose upon the face of all of the creation that God had put forth in forming this old world of ours. So then we have to come to the conclusion that God wanted a people all unto himself. We find that, of course, as we study the story of Abraham and how God promised Abraham that he'd bring forth many nations and under him and in his lineage, and that his chosen vessels would be in the lineage of Isaac and Jacob. And so that brings us to the point today where we are. And we find that we've not done a very good job as a people in keeping the purity and the characteristics and righteousness that God intended for his people to have. You see, as I read the scripture, I'm convinced that God intended for his people from the very beginning to bring forth a holy, a righteous, determined people to serve the Lord in purity and without ungodliness and evil intentions and so forth. Well, we see where that has gotten us, and we find that Adam sinned. We've talked about that, and we find that Jesus came forth born of a virgin, and we've talked about that, Jesus being the second Adam or the last Adam. And then we come to the place where now the people are gathering around the Lord Jesus Christ, and they're beginning to quiz him about the situation involving husband and wife. Now let us go from there to Ephesians chapter 5, and I'm going to begin reading with verse 25. Now we find that this is a portion of scripture that gives specific instruction for a man's conduct and responsibility toward his mate, his wife. What do we find? Well, Ephesians 5:25 makes it very clear. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. Think upon that now. Husbands, love your wives as Jesus loved the church and gave himself for it. Oh my. Well, that puts me as a husband, and it puts any of you out there who are husbands or plan to be a husband, and that when we come into that point of responsibility, that we have an obligation to establish our family in the righteousness of the Lord Jesus Christ. That we are literally to come to a point where we take unto ourselves a wife and treat her as Jesus treats the church. Well, the church, of course, is that body that we commonly call the church, but it is really individuals who have made their commitment to serve the Lord, have repented of their sin, been washed in the waters of baptism, and have come forth with a declaration that they're going to serve the Lord, have been converted to the righteousness of Jesus Christ, and have been set free from that terrible bondage of the law that came upon us when Adam sinned. I want to get into the verses that are so very important for men to live by in taking the responsibility of developing a home and rearing children to the glory of God. Christ loved us enough to die for us. That's the first thing that's important. Husbands, if you take a wife unto yourself, you're responsible to take care of her, to watch over her, to prepare for her to have a decent life, to see to it that she is covered and protected and preserved, that she is kept in a condition and an attitude within the household that brings glory to you, the man. And you, the man, as a husband, are supposed to bring glory to God by treating your wife like Jesus Christ has treated the church down through the ages. Now, Jesus is not a condemning Lord. He is a Lord of love, long-suffering, patience, and He's a Lord of discipline and direction and guidance. And He's a Lord of protecting and ministering to the needs of both the husband and the wife, who, by the way, together make up His bride. And we find that as we look at Him, He is one whose arms are always outstretched, eager and quick to forgive, always anxious to instruct and guide and teach those who serve Him the ways of the Father of us all, our Heavenly Father, the mighty God. And He's always submissive to His Heavenly Father, as we're to be to the Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and Redeemer. Our very spiritual life and our eternal destiny is all wrapped up in the Lord Jesus Himself. Without Jesus, you and I would have no possibility of ever being set free from the bondage of the law of sin and death. And remember, the wages of sin is always death, and judgment follows throughout the ages. Now, keeping that in mind, let's go to verse 26. That He might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the Word. Jesus is intent on guiding, instructing, providing, explaining, delivering the Word of Almighty God unto His bride, unto you and me, regardless of gender. He wants us to know His way. He wants us to follow the narrow path that leads to eternal life. He has prepared us and will prepare us day by day to grow in the knowledge and understanding of His Word, which, by the way, He said what He speaks that comes from the Father. It is not His thoughts, but the Father's thoughts. And He makes it plain that He came to earth in the form of man, that He might, as man, communicate with man and cause him to be prepared and equipped to live an overcoming life, to find happiness and joy and peace, and to be a beautiful element of His creation, and to take responsibility for that which He had provided for us upon the earth. And He intended for us to be such that we had knowledge of everything we needed to know, that we might be what God wants us to be as the bride of Christ. In verse 27, it declares that He might present it to Himself, a glorious church. That He might present what to Himself? His bride, the church. Now, we know that the church is not in the buildings that are made of brick and mortar and steel and all of the things that we have in modern technology today in construction area and provision for a covering and housing for ourselves, businesses, and so forth. We know that He wants us to be prepared and to become so informed in the Word of God and in the love of the Father that we can come to that point where we can be presented unto the Lord Jesus Christ when He returns for His bride as a glorious church, a church that's without spot or wrinkle. It goes on to say, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Now, so far, what I have said to you is, men, when you take a bride unto yourself, when you take a wife unto yourself, you need to realize that you are to present her with a husband that is a spiritual leader, that is a leader with humility and knowledge and understanding that comes straight from the Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father, that you are to keep yourself pure and clean and righteous, faithful unto her as Jesus Christ is faithful unto both his heavenly Father and to you and all of us that serve him as the kingdom of God, his bride to come. And we are his bride already right here on the earth, of course, but he's coming back and we're going to have a whole new and wonderful and different role. But you see, while we are here on earth without that coming to fulfillment yet, he expects us to be as pure and clean, wholesome and upright, honest and helpful and geared, as it were, with our purpose to make our wives and to bring our wives into such a wonderful and glorious posture, both unto ourselves, but also unto the Lord Jesus Christ, because he wants both of us, man and woman, and our children, to be in a position of purity and holiness in this ungodly world in which we live. Our kingdom is the kingdom of God. This world is not our kingdom. Our kingdom is heavenly. It's spiritual. It's eternal. It's also tangible. Because, again, the Bible tells us that there will be a day come when this old world will be destroyed and the heavens will roll up like a scroll, and there's going to be a new heaven and a new earth, and there's going to be a new Jerusalem. It's going to be a beautiful and glorious situation. Jesus Christ, of course, being Lord and King over it all. And we, the citizens of his kingdom, will serve as his bride. We will serve as his helpmeets. Think about that. And as that, we will be responsible for various elements and organization and activities of the new and whole and completely pure kingdom of God that shall rule in the ages to come, in the new heaven and the new earth. It's a glorious thought and a wonderful, wonderful goal to set ourselves forth for. Well, now, what does that mean to us as men who have taken unto ourselves wives, and we're responsible for them? I think we already understand that. And verse 28 declares, "So ought men to love their wives as their own bodies. He that loveth his wife loveth himself." You need to realize, men, if you are a husband or planning on becoming one, you need to understand that you have an awesome responsibility to that woman that you take unto yourself to be both your wife and your helpmeet. Your wife will be both a helpmeet and a helpmate. The helpmeet part of her is to fill in the areas that you have in your life that are not quite as efficient or understandable to you. You need some help in certain areas of your life, both spiritually and physically. It's really true. There's nothing like the encouragement that comes from a godly wife who is able to look at her husband, and when she sees that he's fighting a battle, when she sees that he's being inundated by the attack of the enemy, has a need perhaps to be a little bit more proficient, or has a need for some kind of gift that she can provide in a help meet position, and she looks at him, and there she is. She says, Honey, it's okay. Remember, we're serving the Lord. Remember, Jesus will never forget us. Remember the call that he put upon your life years ago, and he hasn't changed that call. He's not going to fail you now. You say, what are you talking about, Pastor? Well, I don't know about you, but every once in a while, I get tired in my body. And when I get tired in my body, I'm not my best in the profession and the obligations of doing those things in my spirit that I need to do in ministry unto the Heavenly Father, unto my Lord and Redeemer, and unto my wife and children and others round about me. And so it's an encouragement. It's a wonderful thing Now, I know men, there's some men that are very gifted in one area or another. I know men that are very gifted in handling money. I know men that are very ungifted, very careless, very inept in the ability to handle money. Now, men, you may not like to hear what I'm going to say, but it may very well be that God has given you a wife that is much better at it than you. Let her have her ministry. Let her be the helpmeet to help you in the areas of weakness. There are others who you may have a gifted ability in a lot of other ways, but you may have some areas where you're not so good. One of the areas that I have that is not so good, I have a very, very difficult time, and probably some of you have noticed that already. I have a very difficult time in remembering names. I can remember faces, I can remember meeting people, I can remember where and when I met them, but sometimes I cannot recall their names. And often, my little bride will be close to me and she'll see me pause and she'll say quietly, "That's Jim," or whatever the name might be. And I'm able to flow then in that area where I'm so weak that I would not be able to flow if she wasn't there by my side as a helpmeet. Now, on the other side of the coin, we find that she's also a helpmeet. Now, you men know that we are made differently, and I'm not talking about just physiologically, but we are made differently emotionally. We're made different with the ability to see things and to produce things in our mind and to be productive in one measure or another in a multitude of different ways. And sometimes we find ourselves in a situation where we're not so good. Now, one thing that comes to mind, and this is a personal illustration of what I'm talking about, I have a great desire to love my wife. I want to love her with every ounce of my being, but if my wife, thank God she's not like this, if my wife holds me at arm's length and will not allow me to love her or to enjoy the relationship emotionally with each other, and I'm over here and she's over here, and we don't really have the same values or the same desire or the same abilities to enjoy the tangible life that God has given us in this old carnal nature of ours, the body that's still not pure and complete yet, but it will be. But as we live in this old body, we have needs and we have desires and we enjoy. Now, I can talk about the intimate relationship, and that is that God gives direction about how that's to be handled. And maybe we'll get to that today. Probably we'll get to that in the next study when we talk about the wives and their responsibility to husbands. But each have an equal responsibility unto the other. And we want you to keep that in mind as we go on in this instruction. Now he continues in verse 29, "For no man ever yet hated his own flesh, but nourisheth and cherisheth it, even as the Lord the church." He's talking about not only our natural, physical areas, but he's also talking about our emotional areas. He's talking about our spiritual areas. And he's saying that we are to minister to our wives like he ministers to us. Well, how does he minister to you? When I'm heavy laden and downtrodden and find myself in a place of weariness from spiritual battle, I find that my Lord is always there. I recall a song that has a chorus that has grown particularly precious to me. And it goes something like this: "Standing somewhere in the shadows, you'll find Jesus. He's reaching out with his hand. And if you look, you'll find him there." I don't remember the words exactly, but that's the message of the chorus of the song. He's always with you. We need to come to the place where we realize that our wives are our priority, second only to the Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father. Now, men, when you take a wife unto yourself, you have set yourself apart from mommy and daddy. Oh, you say, Pastor, I just can't leave my mommy, I can't leave my daddy. Then you need to forget having a wife, because there's no place for them to end your life over her life. She is your priority. That means, men, that you need to be careful about how you deal with your natural areas of recreation and enjoyment. Are you shutting her out of your life, or are you allowing her to come in and be a part of that part of your life that you enjoy so much? Are you the kind of a guy that has to have a night out with the guys once a week or once a month? Forget it. You need to remember that when you took a wife unto yourself, you took someone that is a precious, priceless jewel that God gave unto you, if you had sense enough to make the right choice. And as a result, you are to refine her, you are to comfort her, you are to be there for her, you are to become her covering, and you are to become a part of her as she has become part of you when you come together in marriage. The two of you become one. The Bible says that. The Bible says that's God's intention. And the Bible says that God made male and female for that very purpose. And so your obligation is no longer to your parents. It doesn't mean that you kick them out in the street, leave them destitute somewhere, that you can't have fellowship with them. But they are secondary. I know what it's like to deal with situations that are difficult. And I know there are many times that the wife is not accepted by the groom's or the husband's mother. And the husband has a terrible time separating himself from mommy or maybe daddy and giving himself 100% to his wife. When you said, "Will you marry me?" or when you established a relationship in acknowledging that you want to be her husband, you need to be able to do it having been pure and not having had immoral relationships with other women. That's a bad thing. You say, "Well, why is that a bad thing, Pastor?" Because, first of all, God said we're not to do it. Secondly, God said that it's sin. Thirdly, God said that when that happens, you become one with that other person and you become one flesh. And now you do not have anything that is pure. You do not have anything that is holy. You do not have anything that has not been contaminated in relationship. And you're going to find yourself in a situation that's very difficult. Now, the same goes for the wife. She is to be pure, never having any relationship sexually with another man until she meets and marries her husband. God intended for us to come together in purity and in a relationship that is all-inclusive. I become part of my wife, she becomes part of me. We are no longer two, we are one. Helping, strengthening, guiding, directing, teaching, supporting, in all the ways that the wife needs for her husband to be. Well, what are all those ways? Well, Jesus said it very well. He said, as Jesus, as Christ, loves the church, we are to love our wife. Acknowledge the fact that most of the time, we men in our corrupt, unpurified mind and body often neglect the real things of value in relationship with our wife. What do we do about that? What did Jesus do in his relationship with us? When you call out upon him, when you look to him for wisdom and knowledge through the gift of the Holy Spirit that he left with us, when you find yourself in a position where you want to draw close to him and have a sweet fellowship with him, remember your wife wants to have a sweet fellowship with you. And that includes being able to talk to her, make her your best friend, confide in her your needs, your wants, your dreams, and your hopes, both of the present and the future. Be a part of enjoying her with a light heart and a pure heart, and acknowledging that she's the most precious jewel that could ever be given unto you, because she is not only your helpmate, but she's also your helpmeet. And you begin to look and see what Christ does for us. Now, do we make mistakes? Yes, we do. We make mistakes spiritually too, don't we? What happens? Well, the minute we make a mistake spiritually, the Lord says, okay, had enough of you, you're done, get out of here, leave me alone, don't want anything to do with you anymore. Is that the way Jesus responds? Not at all. He responds and says, come unto me, all you that are heavy laden, weighted down with care and concern. Come unto me, I'll help you. Are you open to let your wife come to you at any time, no matter what you're doing, and present herself at a time of need? Are you open to receive her, to drop whatever it is at the moment? Now, I realize that sometimes there are situations that you just can't at that very second take a break, but at the same time you can acknowledge her presence, her need, and let her know that you'll be right there, you're there to help her just in a moment, and then make time, arrange yourself in such a way that you can put things on the shelf or on hold until her need is met. She must be first in your life, just as we are first in the life of the Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us. It's very simple and very easy when we put it together. Sad to say, many men become irritated with their wives. They will do something, and instead of getting, well, that's all right, honey, we'll work it out, they get, well, how dumb are you? Don't you have any brains? Seems to me like you ought to have better sense than that. No, no. That's not the way you treat a wife. How do you treat a wife? Come here, honey. Come here. Just let me hold you for a moment. Just let me encourage you for a moment. We'll take care of the problem. We'll get through it together. But no, I'm not going to leave it to you just to deal with it by yourself. And no, I'm not going to be so self-centered that you become secondary in my life. You are my first obligation and responsibility in this world in which we live. That means you make a living for her. That means that you care and comfort her. That means that you provide her with the easiest life possible. That means that you have a tenderness in your heart, a compassion for her need and areas of weakness that she may have. And instead of condemning her, what does Jesus do when you deal with him and he deals with you? He teaches you. He guides you. He encourages you. He stretches forth his arm to help you. He answers your prayer. He lets you know that he's there with you, that you're not standing against an enemy alone or a difficult situation by yourself, but he's there. He's there for you. In like manner, men, we are to be the same for our wives. It's important for us to learn. Well, I think I want to keep my old friends. I want to be just like I was before. I'm going to enjoy them at the expense of my wife. Is that what you're saying? Are you going to be able to say to them, no, I think I'm going to go on home. I have a wife there, and I have children there, and I need to be there. Which decision will you make? Oh, another thought. Finances are tight, very difficult. Income is not enough to meet the need and the expenditure of the household. The bill collector begins to call. The bill collector knocks on the door. Whatever happens in all of that situation, do you sort of close yourself off from all of that? You don't talk to them on the phone. You don't answer the door. You leave the house and let your wife take care of the problem. And then when she takes care of the problem to the best of her ability, do you yell and scream at her for the foolish decision that she made that you wouldn't make at all? Think about this. You are responsible for your household just as much and powerfully as Jesus is responsible for your life as you have committed yourself unto His guidance and care as your Lord and Redeemer. We probably have a lot to learn, men, and I could go on with various illustrations, but again, I see time's getting away. Well, I want to speak more to verse 29 for a moment. This business that men love their own bodies and they don't hate their own flesh. I have known men that do hate their flesh, but that comes after they have long before lost any respect for themselves and any feeling of obligation to be worth anything in responsibility to either themselves or others. But any man who has responsibilities and will not shirk those responsibilities is somewhat careful for his own looks, his appearance, his attitude, his point of success in the obligations in this world, and takes responsibility, walks in integrity, and lives unto God and unto his wife in such a way that he is both a glory to his Lord and that he is a glory unto his wife. I learned a long time ago, and I think that you need to listen to this very carefully. The basic thing a wife needs is to be acceptable and needed by her husband. You need to know something. God made the woman to need her husband. That's why the Bible says in the first and second chapter of Genesis that he called her to be dependent upon him. And he, in turn, is to be dependent upon the Lord Jesus Christ and God the Father. So your wife needs to be needed. If you don't let her take the role that God created her to be, she'll never be fulfilled. Now, it isn't a matter of just being fulfilled in the intimate relationship of husband and wife. It's talking about being needed as the other part of you. She is part of you. And when you cut her off and push her aside, you've taken half of yourself and rejected it. That don't work very well, does it? Are you arrogant and selfish and somehow all wrapped up in yourself with a haughty spirit, and you have the idea and take the form that, woman, you just take your place and get over there and do what you're supposed to do, and I want you to do it now. I don't need you messing with me and my life. Are you able to say to her, honey, what do you think about this? Honey, how do you feel about this? Honey, do you think I look okay? Honey, do you think that I'm taking care of business as I ought to? Honey, is there anything I can do to help you? Honey, what do you need today? Maybe all she needs is a kind word. It may be all she needs is a hug for 10 seconds. It may be all she needs that day is just to know that you love her, that you respect her, and that she is the most precious thing in your life. On the other hand, it may be that she needs a great deal more. And whatever she needs, it's your responsibility and mine to see to it that our wives are cared for as the Lord and the Heavenly Father care for us. For this cause shall a man leave his father and mother, and shall be joined unto his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. Now that was in the first two or three chapters of Genesis, and now all at once here it is in Ephesians in the New Testament. So God's standard for who a wife is and what she is to be, and who a man is and what he is to be, has not changed. It's still the same. The world says it's changed. The world says, leave them and the kids behind and go do your thing. You got to take care of your own wants and your own desires, your own needs, and you got a wife, let her take care of it. That's the attitude of the world. The attitude, we'll get into this when we talk about wives, but the attitude of the wife is, he don't care, I don't care. And so what happens? You marry this cute, beautiful vessel, just the very apple of your eye, exactly what you were hoping you'd receive and what you fell in love with and what you want to be yours forever. But because of the way you treat her in a couple of 3 or 4 or 5 years, instead of being that well-kept, well-dressed, well-manicured woman that was so beautiful and pretty to you, and you took her under yourself as your wife and your helpmeet, now you have forced her in a position where she doesn't matter anymore in your eyes. And what happens? She loses her desire to keep herself. She loses her desire to watch her hygiene. She has no longer cares about whether she looks nice in public or in the house. I'll tell you what, if the time comes when your wife doesn't care what she looks like in the house, she doesn't care what she looks like in public. And you need to understand that in all likelihood, a great deal of it is your fault. This is a great mystery. But I speak concerning Christ and the church. Now he is, the Lord Jesus, is using this illustration as he deals with it through the Apostle Paul as he's preaching and teaching in Ephesus. And what happens? He says, I'm speaking about the church. I'm using what the family life should be in Christ, in me, Jesus speaking. But I'm also using that as an illustration of what I am to the church. So it's a great mystery. He's using family life as God intended for it to be, and as God has given us the ability to walk in His recipe for happy life. He expects us then, likewise, to be the kind of a bride that prepares ourselves for the glorious return of our Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and our King, and indeed His bride we are to be. That's awesome. If we look at it carefully, verse 33 sums it up. Nevertheless, let every one of you in particular, that means individually with special care and concern, so love his wife even as himself, and the wife see that she reverence her husband. Now, what does that word reverence mean? Does she worship her husband? Not necessarily, but in a sense, yes. She does. She looks at him with pride. She looks at him with a sense of admiration and fulfillment. She looks at him as one who meets her every need, as one who is dependable, as one who is always there. Even when circumstances of this world take us apart for a period of time, a season that none of us enjoy if our relationship is what it ought to be at home. But it happens. And yet, she knows that no matter how far away we are, she's still being thought of. She is still the apple of our eye. She is still our pride and joy. And likewise, she knows that as we leave the house and go wherever we have to go by ourselves, generally in business of some kind, then she knows that when we come home, that we're going to come home as pure and as considerate and as careful in possessing ourselves and walking in discipline without sin, and come home that pure husband that left the house when he had to depart. Men, in this day of modern age, modern technology, there is no excuse for however far apart we are, at least sometime within a few hours, making contact with that wife and family that we left at home when we had to go to do something else. Or are you so caught up in your fun and your pleasure and your business or whatever that you don't even remember they exist until it's time for you to go home? Yeah, I know, Pastor, but you don't know what my house is like. In fact, I feel better with my business associates and out taking care of business than I... Well, just to be honest with you, Pastor, I don't even find any pleasure in going home. Oh. Well, why not? Well, my wife. No. Why? It's your fault, not hers. You've not measured up. You've not proven yourself to be to her what Jesus is to you. You haven't walked in the pattern and the recipe that God has given you to be a good husband and a good father. I don't want to hear it. By this time, you're probably getting ready to turn it off. Well, leave it on because you need to hear the rest of it. Nevertheless, I say it again. Let every one of you, in particular, special attention, set apart, separated from everything else, so love his wife even as himself. Now, I know there are some men out there that are worthless. And I know there are some men out there that are disgusting. And I know there are men out there that are anything that they claimed to be before you said, yes, I'll marry you. I know that. And I also know that God deals with that, and He gives a recipe for handling that situation as well. We'll get into that in another study. But men, if you be what Jesus Christ wants you to be toward your wife, and that is to be what He is to you, then you need to understand your wife will do anything in this world to please you because God put within her when He took her from Adam and made her a female for Adam to enjoy and to have as a helpmeet, a friend, a worker beside him, as well as the mother of his children. When you come to that point, you'll find that your wife will do anything in the world she can to make you happy. Don't make it impossible for her to be happy because of your arrogance or insensitivity or a harsh personality or any of the things that you might use as an excuse. You need to be what Jesus is to you, and you need to be that to her as her husband. By the way, I want to say this, lest I forget it. No marriage can succeed, and no marriage will succeed, if your only reason for getting married is the outward appearance and the desire for your genes to be satisfied in intimate activity, and that's your total purpose of getting married, and you even get married with the attitude, well, if this doesn't work out, it's okay, I'll just get a divorce and go my separate way. If you get married intending to fail, you'll fail, and so will she, and you'll never have a totally happy home. One more thing I want to say to you while I still have time to do it, and that is, no marriage can succeed unless each of you serve the Lord with all of your heart. Because if you don't, if one is a Christian, a firm believer, loves the Lord, and the other refuses to serve the Lord and wants to do her own ungodly or his ungodly thing, you're in a situation where you have divided the household before you organized it. And that which is divided, that which is built on sand, will not, cannot stand the trials and the tests of days to come. Again, I want to stress to you, yes, marriage is a developing work, both sides of the marriage. Each of you have to get to know each other. Each of you have to get to trust each other. Each of you have to love each other. Though the Bible says the woman does not have to love the husband, but she does have to respect him, reverence him. And it's been my experience, when a woman can do that, her love is overflowing. It's constant. It just comes to the surface and flows toward the man, the husband, the love of her life. And she will love you, though God doesn't say and command her to love you. He does command you to love her as much as Jesus loves the church and died for it. That means, beloved, if a time comes when you have to stand in the gap between your life and her life, you give your life for her well-being. It's your job to cover, protect, keep, and provide. That little one that you married. Well, you say, mine wasn't very little when I married her. Well, you chose her, you loved her, and you enjoyed her to the point you asked her to marry you. Then that's what you wanted. Don't change your mind now. But love her. Love her. Love her. Love her without measure. And beloved, the Bible says when we sow, we reap what we sow. Men, if you sow love, patience, tenderness, kindness, appreciation, enjoyment, all of the things that certainly in your capacity to give to your wife, to your mate, to your helpmeet, if you do that, what happens? You have sown. Now as you have sown, it comes back to you through her in many different ways. You can have a glorious household, happy, fulfilled, and at peace. If you serve the Lord and direct and teach your family to do likewise, you're going to have the most precious and wonderful relationship, peace, and enjoyment this world can afford. Nothing else takes its place. And so, beloved, with that, I must close and prepare to serve communion. God bless you. We'll be right back. So now here in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 23, "For I have received of the Lord, which also I delivered unto you, that the Lord Jesus, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, Take, eat, this is my body, which is broken for you. This do in remembrance of me. And after the same manner also he took the cup. And when he had supped, he said, This cup is the New Testament in my blood. This do ye as oft as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you do show the Lord's death till he come. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup of the Lord unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastened of the Lord, that we should not be condemned with the world." I just want you to know that as we dwell upon that, have a short prayer, we'll eat together. Father, if there be any uncleanness in any of us, Lord, I pray that you'll forgive me. Lord, I pray that those that are joining us will ask the same of you, that you'll forgive them. And Lord, we ask you to help us to receive the remembrance of what you suffered for us as we take of the sacrament before us, the bread that represents your body and the juice of the vine that represents your blood. And so, Father, cleanse us and make us whole and draw us close to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us eat together. As we take of the bread, represents the price Jesus paid to meet every need in this earth that this old body of ours needs. Let us eat to his glory. Now as we take of the cup, it represents the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, spilled in the ground for you and for me, that we might be cut off from that bondage of the law of sin and death, and that we might be that new creation, that new creature in Christ Jesus, because of the price he paid for us. A new spirit within, the righteousness of our Lord. And so let us drink together in his name. Praise his name. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Thank you for listening to Christian Living 101. Remember, we are totally dependent upon your prayers and generosity. Log on to ChristianLiving101.org. There are over 300 video Bible studies there, plus many other items of interest with Pastor Applegate. We welcome your prayer requests and your questions. Please contact us at Christian Living 101. That's P.O. Box 72150 in Phoenix, Arizona, 85050. Or email Gene at Gene, with a G-E-N-E, Gene at ChristianLiving101.org.